Some 700 billion pesos, or 12% of the budget, is allocated to debt burden. The education sector is still getting the lion's share of the budget, followed by transportation, public works, social welfare, and health. Secretary Pangandaman vows the government will continue to invest on infrastructure to spur economic growth.
Infrastructure development is one of the key drivers of our continuing economic growth. As such, we will sustain this momentum through Build Better More program with 1.42 trillion pesos, equivalent to 5.3% of our GDP. This will prioritize physical connectivity infrastructure such as road networks and railway systems, which will cover almost half or 43.5% of the budget.
House Speaker Martin Romualdez says Congress will prioritize the passage of the spending bill.
The national budget is crucial to maintaining economic stability, sustaining the country's growth trajectory, and facilitating the seamless implementation of government projects and programs. As such, it demands the House's utmost attention and commitment.
The Marcos administration is also seeking 10 billion pesos in surveillance funds next year. That's the same amount with the current fiscal year. Now, most of these funds are allocated under President Marcos's office as well as of Vice President Sara Duterte's. In the proposed spending plan, both Marcos and Duterte get separate confidential funds as agriculture and education chiefs, respectively. The Defense Department also gets more than 2 billion pesos. Budget Secretary Amena Pangandaman gives her assurance the funds have enough safeguards against misuse.
Alam niyo po, yung confidential and intel funds, meron naman pong guidelines yan from COA on how to use the funds. Hindi naman po siya budget na parang pagkabigay, they can actually disburse it and use it. Meron din pong dokumento na sinasubmit po sa COA. And then may breakdown din po yan when we request the budget. So it's not, there's full transparency po in terms of the request for these funds.
The Philippine government's debt hits a new record in June. Data from the Treasury Bureau show the total outstanding debt hit 14.15 trillion pesos, up nearly 0.5% from the previous month. It's also 10.6% higher from the same period a year ago. This on the back of more domestic borrowings, which rose 1.2%. The Bureau says domestic debt grew in June due to the net issuance of government bonds driven by government's financing requirements.
Manila's top economist is confident the government can achieve its 6 to 7% economic growth target this year, despite a slowdown among its trade partners. NEDA Secretary Arsenio Balisacan tells ANC the country only needs an average of 5.9% for the last three quarters of the year to hit a 6% growth. The Philippine economy expanded 6.4% in the first quarter.
The trick is to ensure that the domestic economy is working well. And I think we have that move for us to remove all restrictions in the pertaining to the COVID-19 is a good support to that effort. The effort focus on the an infrastructure, an investment, particularly on the ease of doing business in the country.
Balisacan also saying the damage caused by recent calamities is not that substantial. The country recorded 5.4 billion pesos worth of agriculture and infrastructure damage due to Typhoon Egay and the southwest monsoon.
So far, in the case of basic commodities like rice, we have adequate stocks. I think that a lot of the imports came in the first half of the year, and that I think allows us to have that buffer. So, in the meantime, I think that the impact on inflation is not going to be that much, but it's still, you know, as I said, the events are still unfolding, and the thing is, this is July, August, and so it's not really the harvest season in many parts of the country for the basic agricultural products. So and it's so I think that the damage is not that substantial, and so I do think that the impact on the overall national economy is that serious at this point.
The Philippine Agriculture Department also allaying concerns over damaged crops due to widespread flooding in the country. Undersecretary for Rice Industry Development, Leocadio Sebastian, says the crops are still in their early stages and can still be recovered. He adds recent rains were also a big help to the country's agriculture sector as it elevated the water level in dams that are crucial for irrigation.
Yung sa palayan kasi, pagka katatanim pa lang, pwede pa yan makapag-recover pagka kahit na nabahayan. Basta hindi lang yung lubog ng mahigit 2 linggo. Yung masyadong matagal nang nakalubog, talagang mamamatay na yung palay. But kung yan malulubog lang ng mga 2-3 araw, makaka-recover pa siya. So yun ang ibig sabihin nun. At kung yun naman mga bagong tanim lang at na-wash out, pwede pa nating habulin, mag-replant. Ang bagyo naman, meron ding, kailangan din natin ang bagyo Huwag lang tumama sa atin. Kasi pagka walang bagyo, wala rin ulan, hindi rin maganda. Kaya yung bagyo na, yung dumating na bagyo, nakakatulong din na mapilapan yung ating mga dams para din naman sa ating pagtatanim pagdating ng El Nino, so yung mga irrigated areas natin.
Over now to the deadly Rizal boat mishap. The Rizal Provincial Police says some survivors are now claiming there were no Coast Guard personnel on duty when the boat set sail. Initial investigations showed the boat that capsized was overloaded. The tragedy left 27 dead. Complaints have been filed against 5 people, including the boat's captain and owner.
Isa po sa salaysay din po na walang naka-duty nung araw. Nasa porto din po ng Binangonan Police Station ang boat captain, while yung 4 po na respondent pa natin ay at large.
So walang nag-account. So kailangan talagang seryosohin na ng ating kumpanyas o mga personnel na napapatupad ng ating mga existing na mga batas. So matatalak.
The Philippine Environment Department says a 3.6 billion peso grant from the European Union could be used to improve solid waste management. Environment Secretary Maria Antonia Yulo Loizaga says the grant could be ready by November. She reveals 10 local government units who may benefit from the fund have been identified.
Perhaps to just point out that under the consideration of this grant would be the involvement of the local government. So initially po, we have identified about 10 LGUs that could potentially be part of this program for improving their circular economy locally, no? And of course, climate change mitigation because of the control of the methane releases from the management of the solid waste.
Meanwhile, Loizaga also calls for the repurposing of single-use plastics that make up a bulk of the country's solid waste. According to a World Bank study, the Philippines generates around 61,000 metric tons of solid waste daily.
Many of our plastic waste can actually be transformed for economic value. Now, yung economic value po calculated by the World Bank, about 790 to 890 million US dollars po per year. In order for us to generate that economic value, we do need to make some changes in terms of the way we collect, recover, and repurpose itong mga plastic waste na ito.
Over in China, Typhoon Doksuri, which battered the Philippines' Egay, has killed at least 20 people. It also caused extensive flooding in Beijing and neighboring Hebei province. Electrical lines were down and many roads were either badly damaged or still flooded. China's finance ministry has announced it will allocate 110 million yuan, or about $15 million, for repair and rescue work.
In Japan, one person is dead and 11 others are injured as Typhoon Kanu nears the country's southwestern islands. Around 200,000 homes are also without power. Okinawa's airport in Naha also remains closed, canceling over 950 flights. Roads are flooded and several trees were toppled down. The storm comes at the height of summer tourist season, which has seen visitor arrivals returning to pre-pandemic levels.
Now back here at home, the wreckage of the missing Cessna plane has been found in Apayao province. Our correspondent Jackie Manaba joins us on the line with the details of that. Jackie?
Ron, in a significant development, the Cessna 152 training aircraft that went missing yesterday, August 1, has been located by the search teams in Tuguegarao today, August 2. The Civil Aviation Authority of the Philippines said that the aircraft was found at Barangay Salvacion Luna, Apayao. That's approximately 50 kilometers away from its intended destination, the Tuguegarao Airport. The search and retrieval operations are currently underway to recover the bodies of the two individuals who were on board the aircraft, the pilot and the student pilot. The identities of the victims have not been disclosed, pending notification of their families. The agency has also suspended operations of Echo Air, the operator of the concerned aircraft, until further notice. To ensure a thorough investigation, the Civil Aviation Authority of the Philippines Aircraft Accident Investigation and Inquiry Board dispatched a team of investigators to the crash site. However, their arrival at the location will be contingent upon the completion of the body retrieval process. The AIIB investigators will also examine the wreckage, gather evidence, and interview witnesses to determine the cause of the crash. Their findings will be crucial in understanding the circumstances that led to this unfortunate event. The aircraft with registration number RPC8958 went missing August 1 after departing from Lawag International Airport at 12:16 p.m. It was scheduled to arrive at Tuguegarao Airport at 3:16 p.m. This Cessna 152 is a popular American two-seater fixed tricycle gear general aviation airplane primarily used for flight training or personal use. CAAP said that they will provide updates on the progress of the investigation as they become available. Ron?
That update from Jackie Manaba. Thank you very much, Jackie.
The Vice Governor of Lanao del Sur expressing dissatisfaction with government's efforts to rehabilitate Marawi. Mohamed Khalid Rakin Adion says the administration should have already found shelter for families affected by the siege that gripped the city 6 years ago. His remark came after the Marawi Compensation Board started processing claims for victims of the Marawi siege. The board vows to fulfill its mandate to give compensation to families who lost residential and commercial properties in the five-month war. But it admits it needs more funding.
2,000 katao na po yung inaccept namin ng mga claims. Yung 150 ng July 4 pa lang po, ang estimate po ng kanilang final or nire-request na kabayaran, no, yung kanilang application for claim ay 700 million. Annual po yung pondo. Yung pong amount, maaari po yung lumaki, depende po yan doon sa makikita ng Kongreso. Sana po dahil kukulangin po talaga yan, ma-increase po next year sa 2024 para naman mabayaran natin substantially yung mga nag-file ng claim.
The Land Transportation Franchising and Regulatory Board likely to approve a proposed rush hour rate for jeepneys and buses. Some transport groups have appealed to the board to come up with a measure that would help the sector deal with high oil prices. Under the scheme, 1 peso will be added to the base fare of jeepneys, while the base fare of city buses will increase by 2 pesos during peak commuting hours, which runs from 5 to 8 in the morning and 4 to 8 in the evening except for Sundays and holidays.
Mawawala sa driver ngayon mga 150 pesos a day. Na iyan ay pwede sa computation ko, may pang-almusal na ng kape-tinapay, may pambigas na at saka itlog na mabibili. Yun ang nawala sa kita ng driver ngayon sa 350. And hindi natin ma-expect, baka next week tumaas na naman to.
The Regulatory Board also eyeing an alternative solution by distributing financial aid to affected operators.
In the event na kulang yung fuel subsidy, we may resort to granting the request but not probably as high as 1 peso. Depende po. Now, if the fuel subsidy is not available yet, then we may grant the request for a 1 peso increase. But this will be subject to a study which we are doing right now.
A maritime industry expert urges the Philippines to continue pushing for reforms in its seafaring sector. Dr. and Captain Vivek Jain welcomes the Marcos administration's commitment to improve the industry after the European Union threatened to ban Filipino seafarers from its ships due to training deficiencies. Jain says there has to be a consistent improvement in the quality of education of seafarers.
If any country can ship up, it will be Philippines, because Filipino seafarers are the core of the maritime seafaring community. Shipping is changing very fast. The technology is changing fast. The requirement of green and sustainability skills is required. So okay. They need to shape up, including every stakeholder, including every maritime training institutes. Without that, is either you are in or you are out.
The Anti-Money Laundering Council issues a freeze order against embattled lawmaker Arnolfo Teves Jr. and 12 others who belong to the so-called Teves terrorist group. They were earlier designated as terrorists by the national government. According to the agency, the order shall take effect immediately and will cover banks and insurance companies. Teves and the 12 others have vehemently denied committing any acts of terrorism. Meanwhile, a House lawmaker says she sees a very dangerous trend as the anti-terror law is being weaponized against certain individuals.
I think in the case of Representative Arnie Teves, no, we have all the necessary law na without using yung ATL. Na halimbawa kung related ito sa Degamo case, nandiyan yung ating sapat sufficient yung ating mga batas to make him account. Ang concern lang namin dito, no, yung paggamit ng pagbibigay ng unilateral na power dito sa ATC sa pagde-designate ng terrorist group or terrorist.
Let's now check on the weather here in the Philippines with Pagasa forecaster Altsar Aurelio. Altsar?
Hello and good afternoon to all of you. Right now, we continue to experience for the next 24 hours, rainy days today and tomorrow due to southwest monsoon over Metro Manila, Cordillera, Cagayan Valley, Central Luzon, Carabarzon, and Mimaropa. While the rest of the country will have fair weather, but we expect isolated rain showers and thunderstorms. Please advise that we continue to experience occasional rains, especially we expect moderate to heavy rains over Ilocos region, Zambales, and Bataan. Because of southwest monsoon, we have a gale warning, means we expect high waves due to southwest monsoon over the seaboards of extreme northern Luzon. The wave height expect reach up to 4.5 meters. Here in Metro Manila, we continue to experience another 2 days, today and tomorrow due to southwest monsoon. Expect rainy, particularly rainy. We expect light to moderate rains today and tomorrow. But on Thursday or Friday, we expect generally good weather because the southwest monsoon weakens on that day. That's the update from Pag-asa. I'm Altsar D. Aurelio.
Thanks, Altsar.
Up next, legal trouble piles up for former U.S. President Donald Trump, who's facing another indictment.
And the cost of data breaches for businesses in the ASEAN region hits a new record high. More news when we return. Watching top story here again in the headlines. The Marcos administration submits a proposed 5.7 trillion peso 2024 national budget to Congress. Authorities confirm the missing Cessna aircraft carrying two people crashed in Apayao province.
The Anti-Money Laundering Council freezes the assets of embattled lawmaker Arnolfo Teves Jr., who has been tagged as a terrorist.
And Fitch downgrades America's AAA credit rating, citing an erosion of governance.
Former U.S. President Donald Trump indicted yet again, this time over his attempts to overturn the results of the 2020 election. But as this report tells us, despite his legal troubles, Trump continues to surge ahead in the Republican presidential race.
Donald Trump. Love him or hate him. For many Americans, there seems to be no in-between. The former president has spun his serious federal indictments to his political advantage, claiming the charges are politically motivated.
These are ridiculous indictments, and all they're doing is hoping for massive election interference. That's all they want to do. They want to damage the leading candidate.
With every new indictment, he gets a boost in the polls, giving him a double-digit lead in the Republican race for the nomination. And surprisingly, Trump's many presidential challengers, including its closest challenger, Florida Governor Ron DeSantis, say they agree with him, as do some prominent Republicans in Congress.
Where they go after anybody who's running against the president, it seems as though, and if you go up in the polls, you're more likely to get indicted.
Others direct their ire at Special Counsel Jack Smith, who led the investigation that produced Tuesday's indictment over Trump's attempts to hold on to power after losing the 2020 election.
And what Jack Smith is doing is the weaponized government. And he's weaponizing the Department of Justice against President Trump in a complete lie about President Trump and January 6th.
This support, says University of Texas history professor Jeremy Suri, may be in the candidate's self-interest. He spoke to VOA from Austin via Zoom.
The support that Trump is receiving from other Republican candidates and from other Republican office holders comes from the fact that the Republican primary system is a messed up system. It's a system that gives a small group of Republicans who turn out in these primaries, sometimes they're in caucuses, sometimes they're in voting primaries, they turn out and they don't represent the party, but they do provide the key votes in the primaries that determine who will be the nominee of the party.
The White House has repeatedly said it has no role in Trump's legal woes. While this situation may not be Biden's fault, this is a problem. Suri says the president needs to do three things. One, protect people's access to the vote. Two, make sure the justice system can do its work. And third, he says,
Biden should be educating the public.
He has just over a year to do that before America votes. Anita Powell, VOA News, Washington.
Meta starts blocking Canadians' access to news on Facebook and Instagram. This is in response to a new law requiring tech firms to pay publishers for news content in hopes of bringing in more revenue for the struggling news sector. Meta said news links and content posted by local and foreign news outlets will no longer be viewable by people in Canada. Article sharing on the platform has also been disabled. Another tech giant, Google, is considering a similar move.
Fitch slashes America's long-term default rating from AAA to AA+, pointing to what it called an erosion of governance. Now, Fitch notes there has been a steady deterioration in governance standards in Washington in the last 20 years, including on fiscal and debt matters. Its decision came months after the U.S. averted a catastrophic debt default days ahead of the June deadline. The Biden administration objects to Fitch's move. The White House calling the downgrade as defying reality under an economic rebound since President Joe Biden took office. U.S. Treasury Chief Janet Yellen, meanwhile, called it as arbitrary and based on outdated data. Philippine shares joined the regional downswing Wednesday as investors fret over the lower Fitch credit rating for the United States. This report.
Asian stocks rattled by Fitch's downgrade of U.S. sovereign rating to a notch below top tier, citing an erosion of governance. Philippine shares not spared, with the PSE index dropping 1.7% back to 6,400. China Bank's J.P. Collette blames the surprise Fitch news as souring the mood in Asia, even in Manila, where generally good earnings are expected and headwinds like inflation are seen easing.
Recall the last time there was a credit downgrade in the U.S., I think this was in 2011 by S&P. It really roiled the markets, crashed. So hopefully it will not be as bad.
Meanwhile, trader Harold Tan sees more choppy trade ahead.
We are still living in a erratic and choppy market, as you can see. We traded again below the 6,500 level support, and it might continue for the rest of the week. Let's see how the inflation print on Friday boosts our market.
In corporate stories, Metro Bank reports a 30% growth in second quarter net income to 10.4 billion pesos, bringing first half bottom line to nearly 21 billion pesos on asset expansion, higher margins, and healthy fee income growth. This translates to a 12.9% return on equity, higher than the 10% recorded in the same period last year. In all, gross loans grew 9%. Bank President Fabian SD says as the economy further expands, they see more market opportunities that will keep the upward momentum. Still in banking, the country's oldest bank, BPI, confident it can grow customer base fivefold to 50 million in the next 4 years through digitalization and tapping agency partners such as convenience stores, drug stores, and gasoline stations. BPI President and CEO TG Limcauco notes clients become better customers when on the digital platforms as they tend to do more transactions.
BPI has benefited because most of our loan book comes from top corporates, and the top corporates have been very short duration in terms of their loans, and therefore we are able to pass on any increases that the BSP put into their policy rate. We're able to pass it on to the top corporates. We're not as fortunate on the consumer book. Consumer rates tend to be stickier. We are, and it's very competitive. So, for example, our mortgage rates and our auto rates have not gone high, have not gone up as much as the policy rates have, whereas a top corporate loan has clearly risen about 400 basis points. The corporate sector, last year we grew in the low double digits. This year, I think the corporate sector grows maybe anywhere from 8 to 10. But what's very strong for BPI is our consumer book. Our auto loans are growing about in excess of 20%. Our credit card book is growing in excess of 40%.
Meanwhile, Ayala Land posts an over 40% jump in second quarter bottom line to 6.9 billion pesos, bringing first half net income to 11.4 billion pesos. The Ayala-led developer cites higher residential project completion, bookings, and sales of commercial and industrial lots and office units. In other news, Boitis Equity Ventures and Coca-Cola Euro-Pacific Partners enter into a non-binding letter of intent with the Coca-Cola Company to acquire 100% ownership in Coca-Cola Beverages Philippines at an enterprise value of $1.8 billion on a debt-free, cash-free basis. This is aligned with the Aboitiz Group's diversification strategy to enter the branded consumer goods space and the Coca-Cola Company's intention to divest its bottling operations. The ownership structure will be 60-40 between CCEP and AEV. Finally, Mang Inasal, which is a sister company of listed Jollibee Foods Corp., is bullish about the growth prospects as revenge dining continues. Mang Inasal President Mike Castro shares the brand is looking to nearly double store count and enter the 1,000 store club. The business is 90% franchise.
We've been growing our digital and delivery business by 20 times since 2019, and we're very happy that the entire Mang Inasal network, our employees, and our partner franchisees are with all of us in this growth now. And as dine-in comes in, we believe that the takeout and delivery will continue to grow. A lot of growth available for us, Mimi. No? We will be growing by next year. We will be hitting the 600 mark. And we'll be growing by 10 to 15% every year. So we're very excited. Our sister company, Jollibee, is more than 1,000 stores, and we believe we can be in that level in 5 to 6 years' time as well.
The Bureau of Internal Revenue backs President Marcos's push to tweak parts of the corporate recovery and tax incentives for enterprises or create law to address issues raised by investors. Among these issues, the imposition of 12% value-added tax for indirect exporters, VAT refund claims, and problems on ease of doing business.
Sa policy issue that kung sasabihin ni Presidente at ng ating mga Congress at ng DOF ay susuportahan natin yan.
The CREATE law essentially cuts corporate tax rates while rationalizing incentives given to investors. The BIR is ramping up collections after posting a shortfall of 11 to 20% in the first half of the year. It's targeting to collect some 2.639 trillion pesos for this year.
President Marcos met with executives of Pacific Broadband Satellites in Malacanang with digital connectivity and cybersecurity topping their agenda. Marcos emphasized the need for the country to catch up with its Asian neighbors. He also directed the ICT department as well as the science and technology department to determine specific terms with Pacific on how to boost a country's digital capability. Pacific is planning to launch its Pacific 2 satellite to add capacity to its existing satellite, the Pacific 1, which was launched in 2019.
The average cost of a data breach in the Philippines and the rest of ASEAN hits a new record high. Based on its annual report, IBM Security pegged that figure at $3.05 million, a 6% increase from last year. Financial services and energy companies saw the highest breach costs. The study also found organizations with extensive use of artificial intelligence and automation cut breach life cycles by 99 days and reduced data breach costs by nearly $1.25 million. The data breach report is based on analysis of data breaches experienced by 553 organizations globally.
The National Tobacco Administration warns illicit tobacco trade could cost the Philippines some 30 billion pesos in lost revenue this year. Jackie Pascual with that story.
Yeah, about 16 billion pesos in revenue is lost due to the illicit tobacco trade in the Philippines so far this year. The NTA, or the National Tobacco Administration, said the figure is still expected to go up, affecting many farmers this 2023. At the International Tobacco and Agricultural Summit in Taguig, NTA Administrator Belinda Sarmiento Sanchez said the agency continues to help local farmers because of the illegal trade, which covers smuggling and unregistered cigarettes. NTA said that illicit tobacco trade can possibly reach 30 billion pesos of losses this year. This includes smuggling, illicit manufacturing. The NTA has no police powers, so the agency is coordinating with law enforcement agencies to prevent the illegal trade. Aside from the illicit trade, NTA said the government's anti-smoking campaign and the higher taxes on cigarettes are also negatively affecting the tobacco industry. But the agency continues to urge farmers who left the industry to return to planting tobacco as they will now focus on exporting. According to the 2021-2022 data of NTA, 53% of tobacco in the country are exported, while 47% are sold to local manufacturers. Top countries receiving tobacco from the Philippines are the U.S., Dominican Republic, Belgium, Indonesia, and the UAE. One of the speakers, Stanley, is Michael Tan, director of LT Group, which owns and distributes most cigarette brands in the Philippines. He said there is a need to help the tobacco industry as it is still benefiting millions of Filipinos and that revenues from the sector, he said, will help in infrastructure development, healthcare, and education in many regions.
Senator Rizontiveros welcomes the suspension of agriculture officials involved in an allegedly anomalous onion supply deal for Kadiwa stores. But she says the ombudsman should also go after high-ranking officials of the agency. The ombudsman imposed a six-month suspension without pay on Assistant Secretary Christine Evangelista and two other DA officials. Also orders suspended were officials of the government-owned Food Terminal Incorporated. They allegedly violated the procurement law when it chose a multi-purpose cooperative to supply onions for the Kadiwa project. The ombudsman also questioned an advanced payment made to the cooperative despite doubtful deliveries.
Switching gears now, a warm welcome awaits the members of the Philippine National Women's Football Team who have returned home after their historic World Cup stint. Andrea Taguines is on the line for more. Andy?
Hi, Denise. That's right. Our Filipinas have returned home after their historic debut at the world's biggest football tournament, the FIFA World Cup. They were given a hero's welcome here at the Ninoy Aquino National Airport, with some fans even handing out bouquets of flowers to members of the team. But despite their 6-0 loss to world number 12 Norway, the Filipinas are not yet done writing history, or rather, her story. Goalkeeper Olivia McDaniel said getting to play against such strong teams in New Zealand only made them better and more ready as they get back to training in a few days ahead of the Asian Games in September and, of course, the Olympic qualifiers. Team administrator Belay Fernando says they would need to regroup with the departure of head coach Alan Stipes. His contract with the team has ended, but midfielder Sarah Agnevic assured that there's no hard feelings and that they are very grateful to Stipes for helping them get to where they are now. Under Stipes, the Philippine women's national football team jumped to world number 46 in ranking, and they're expected to go even higher after their glorious first ever stint and first victory at the World Cup. The Filipinas are also expected to hold a press con tomorrow, so hopefully we'll be getting a clearer picture of the team's game plan moving forward. Denise?
Thanks, Andy. K-pop supergroup SB19 holds sold-out shows in the cities of San Francisco and Anaheim in California. The quintet also collaborated with Mix Global for a special project in Hollywood. Steve Angelus reports.
A golden weekend in Southern California for Pinoy pop group SB19. Now in the middle of their Pagtatag World Tour that will hit 10 North American cities. 8 months after they made their U.S. debut, SB19 had a sold-out show at the Grove in Anaheim this past weekend.
Yeah, not even a year later, and we're back, and hopefully make more memories.
It's kind of overwhelming. I really didn't think that they were going to be back here this soon, but we're happy nonetheless. So, you know, we're just here to support them as per usual.
One, two, three!
The five-member group, all in their 20s, perform a majority of their music in Tagalog. But that doesn't stop fans known as 18 of all ages, cultures, and from different parts of America from lighting up in the blazing heat wave to share gifts with each other, make new friends, and learn Philippine culture along the way.
I like to learn certain things about those cultures, and I think that's very important to know.
Maryland
66-year-old Fran Bungato Smith came all the way from Maryland. The grandmother of 11 even brought this sign, hoping to adopt another grandson. She discovered SB19 as she was trying to get in touch with her Filipino musical roots.
I've never been a fangirl like this, you know? And my daughters and my grandkids have teased me saying, "What? You must be the oldest fan they have." And I said, "I'm not. There's fans in their 70s, so I'm younger."
Nice.
So I love it. I love them. They're super talented. They're humble. They're hardworking. And they just, there's everything to love about them.
SB19's Loyal 18 is on a different level when it comes to fandom. And that level of fandom is so high that even Billboard has taken notice. They've helped push SB19 to the top of Billboard's Fandom Face-Off.
Fans have propelled SB19 to the semifinals of the Billboard Online Fan Army Face-Off competition. They're facing off against Shakira in the online voting contest. The winner advances to the finals to go up against the winner between Cardi B and K-pop group 17. Winners will be announced at the end of this week. With a widespread support, SB19 made sure to tell fans how much they're appreciated throughout the show, as they wowed the crowd with their classics. And their latest songs. Just then hopped off stage to sing for singer actress Jada Avanzado, who was at the concert with her parents, phenomenal diva Jessa Zaragoza, and the original Pinoy Prince of Pop, Ding Dong Avanzado.
Los Angeles 18, thank you so much for everything. Like, you guys, I can't explain everything, but you guys, oh my God! Thank you guys for everything, the love and support that you've given us, you've shown us. Like, it's a blast.
And even after back-to-back shows in San Francisco on Friday and Anaheim on Saturday, SB19 continued to perform on Sunday, appearing on the Wish Bus at their North Hollywood headquarters. The P-pop idols also teamed up with Mix and Hollywood to film a special upcoming project. A couple hundred fans and onlookers took over Hollywood Boulevard as SB19 bust on the iconic street. The special performance video will be released on Mix's YouTube channel soon. Steve Angeles, ABS-CBN News, Hollywood.
Hundreds flocked to Whitehorse in Canada's Yukon Territory to celebrate the town's second Filipino fiesta. Jolene Rodriguez tells us more.
The Rotary Park in the city of Whitehorse was transformed into a colorful Filipino fiesta as Phil-Canadians celebrated the second Filipino fiesta organized by Canadian-Filipino Association of Yukon, or CFAY. The two-day event is bigger and more fun compared to last year. There are still parlor games like tug-of-war and sack race, sports events like bike relay and volleyball, as well as karaoke and Zumba. True to being a fiesta, different kinds of Filipino food were served during lunch, feeding more than 600 Pinoys and guests. The best part, they are all free. This was made possible through the support of the government of Yukon.
They have full support, like financial and like emotional siguro, or like moral support nila. Marami talaga silang tinutulong sa atin based on nakikita natin nandito.
But the performance of Philippine traditional dances was the highlight of the event. The Yukon Kalingawan dance troupe showcased well-loved folk dances from the Ilocano area of Pangasinan called Binuyugan, Ragragsakan from Kalinga province, and Subli from Batangas. On the other hand, the Philcon dance troupe brought the Yukoners to Baguio as they portray the famous Panagbenga festival in their number. And to complete the Philippine experience, Filipino bands played OPM music.
It's getting better each time, and we really are grateful
Even guests outside Yukon enjoyed the event, like Gloria Rivera, who came from Yellowknife Northwest Territories. It was her first time in White Horse.
Like your beautiful city of Yukon, and your fiesta. That's my first time attending Filipino fiesta, or Canadian Filipino fiesta. That's very, very nice, and lots of people. It's very happy occasion, really. It's really great. You guys are all awesome.
For Filipinos, events like these are not just a welcome break from their daily lives in Yukon. It also takes on a deeper meaning on being a Filipino.
So it just like gives us this feeling of being home, away from home. All the festivities remind us how colorful our culture is. And also this is my way of showing my son what's Filipino tradition and culture.
After the Filipino fiesta, Pinoy's in Yukon are looking forward to the concert of Silent Sanctuary with Jeff Bolivar of Soap Dish this August. Zerlyn Rodriguez, ABS-CBN News, White Horse.
And before we go, catch a discussion about corporate compliance to data protection standards on ANC's Business Outlook. That's later at 8 p.m. We'll be speaking with Roren Marie Chin, the Chief of the Public Information and Assistance Division of the National Privacy Commission.
Those were the top stories today. I'm Denise Tinsai.
And I'm Ron Cruz. You can watch exclusive content and highlights and recaps of our shows online. Thanks for watching.